I'm a city kid. I've always been interested in Asia. So when I went to college in Berkeley, I studied Asian studies. And when I graduated, I decided to travel to Asia just for adventure and to see what it was like there. So right away I met people who were from the Back to the Land movement. This is 1970. So I met some people from the Back to the Land movement, and they were living in remote but very beautiful places in Japan, and they said, "You're welcome to visit, and here's places you can stay all along the way." And so I spent a long time hitchhiking from one commune to the other. And most of these were agricultural communities. And I just fell in love with plants and soil and the outside. It was wonderful. Everything I've done, so I was about 23 years old, everything I've done in my life since then has had to do with plants and soil in one way or another. I was so lucky to find something that just really inspired me. And along those travels in Japan, I heard about this fellow Masanobu Fukuoka, who was a farmer philosopher who was apparently farming with this unusual method that nobody could explain to me, because nobody I knew had ever been to this farm before. I had nothing else to do. It sounded like another adventure, and it certainly was, it turned out. And so I decided to go there, and what I saw was amazing. And at the time, Fukuoka-san was inviting people to come and live in his orchard. He had about an acre and a half of rice fields and a 14-acre orchard. And there were these little huts up there, and about five or six students were living and working on the farm. And he would come up and instruct them on the method and his philosophy. And I asked him, would it be okay if I stayed and became one of your students? And he said, sure. And I dropped everything, and I lived on the farm for 2 years. And while I was there, a book that he had written called The One Straw Revolution was published in Japanese. Now, all of this time, I'll describe his technique and his story in just a minute, but all of this time he had been using this no tillage, don't flood the rice field technique, but people in Japan were not impressed, or they were not into creativity and independent thinking is not really prized in Japan, so he seemed like a eccentric at best, and that was nationwide, I mean everywhere, and also even in his own village, people were couldn't understand at all what he was doing. So when the other students there and I saw this book, which was a perfect introduction, he talks about how he came to be farming the way he did and the method that he used, the farming techniques, and then his opinions about this and that. It was a perfect introduction to it, and we said, oh, if we can translate this book into English and get it published in the United States. Now, this 1970, early 70s, Back to the Land movement and the environmental movement was just getting started, and we knew that people outside would really love to hear about this message. So we said, let's translate the book into English and do that. But we had no idea how to do it, because nobody had any experience with this. We just did the best we could. So we got a friend, translated it into, did a direct translation from Japanese into English. And but he had never been to Fukuoka's farm, and we had to, he wasn't a farmer, so we had to really work over the manuscript and ask him questions about what did you mean by this and that. Anyway, when we got a manuscript that we thought was decent, I was the one who said, go to the United States, Larry. Find a publisher. I didn't know. I was like 25 years old. Anyway. So when I came here, everything went great. The book had total magic. I didn't have to do anything hardly. It found its way to the right places and boom, it was published in 1978 by Rodale Press, which at the time was cutting edge. This is where the environmentalists and Back to the Landers were getting their information and their inspiration from Rodale Press and the Mother Earth News. So the book was a huge hit right away, and since then several things happened. For one thing, Mr. Fukuoka became a star. The book was translated into, has been translated into more than 25 languages, and it sold a million copies worldwide. And he started getting invited to travel to other places, and he came to the United States a couple of times, to Europe a few times, and he went to Africa three times, India five times, China, Philippines, Thailand, all over. And it changed his life because he saw, once he got out of Japan, he saw the severity of the environmental crisis, specifically desertification. And the rest of his life he devoted to, how can I use my understanding of natural farming to re-green the human-caused deserts of the world? Now, for me, I haven't been back to Japan since then. I haven't been back since 1975. But what I've been doing has been three things. One thing is that over the years, I've been trying to explain Fukuoka's philosophy and promote it and do talks like this and give workshops and so forth and writing and articles and so forth. That's one thing. Another thing is that I went back to Berkeley and became a soil scientist. I worked for the California State Department of Forestry. I worked in wholesale and retail nurseries. Again, everything having to do with plants and soil. And then for 25 years, long years, I was a landscape contractor in the San Francisco Bay Area. But during that time, I was raising my daughter, Leah, who's 25 years old now. When she graduated from high school and went off to college in Colorado, I breathed a sigh of relief. I closed my landscaping company, left the city, and moved up to Ashland. And since then, I've been able to devote myself full time back again to sustainable agriculture. I've taught permaculture classes before, but mainly I'm just concentrating on natural farming and so forth. So anyway, so that's the background. Let's talk about Fukuoka-san and his technique and his philosophy. He grew up in a village, in typical village, on the island of Shikoku. His father was the head man of the village and had the largest holdings. And so he had the opportunity to go to college. And he went into agricultural studies, big scale industrial agriculture, and then specialized in plant pathology. And his first job was in Yokohama. And he had this insight while he was there. The way he described it was, he saw nature, he saw the face of nature. Later he said, well, that was nature and the world just as it is, without discrimination, without, he saw it, without discrimination. It's like seeing the plant as different from, I mean, the grasses as different from the trees, as different from people, and the water and the rocks and everything. They were all one and completely interconnected, and it was all put together perfectly, so that each element performed it to its best ability. And people, thinking that they can improve upon nature, fiddle with it. And the outcome cannot be an improvement. It can't be, because nature is already perfect and the human mind is limited. And it can only see a few elements at once, and dealing with those elements, there's no way for people to imagine how what they do is going to affect other elements that they hadn't even been considering. So he tried to explain this to his co-workers and other people, and they couldn't understand it because they were living in a different world, and actually it was the world that he had been living in for his entire life until he had that insight. So what he decided to do was go back to his farm on Shikoku Island and apply this way of thinking to agriculture and create a concrete example and to show how this understanding could be a really great benefit to the world. And he worked at that. For he had no idea what it would look like. Nobody else had ever tried it. There was nobody that he could ask, or no model to follow. So I came to his farm 25 years after that. By the time I got there, his 14-acre orchard was like a jungle paradise, a temperate, subtropical temperate paradise, right in there. And the rice fields, he grew rice and barley in the same fields every year, rice in the summer and barley in the winter. And he didn't plow, and he wasn't flooding the rice fields. So the first thing he did, I'm just going to get some. Stop doing everything. He said, if people are not can't improve things, then I'm just going to stop doing anything. And he was in charge of his orchard at the time, his father's orchard. So he stopped doing anything, and he was just observing nature and walking in the woodlands and seeing how everything was arranged there. And in the meantime, the orchard trees, which had been pruned already, the branches grew in all cockeyed and strange directions, and the light, the sunlight and the air couldn't pass through as easily, and eventually 400 trees died. And he said, this can't be natural farming. This is neglect. And he saw that when people have affected nature and then just leave it, then that's not the way to. People have a responsibility to correct the problems that they've created. So then he looked, with that in mind, he looked around the orchard, and he saw that the topsoil had been eroded completely, and the orchard was kind of sickly citrus trees and a few weeds and a few shrubs. So he went to work, and he improved the soil by establishing a soil-building mixed ground cover, and he started with deep-rooting plants like daikon and burdock and dandelion and dox, and then he added plants like other brassicas, mustard, and radish that have an extensive fibrous root system. And a leguminous ground cover, he tried many, and he found that white clover was ideal for him, partly because it makes a mat on the surface and keeps helps to control weedy grasses. And chicory and comfrey and buckwheat and a whole host of them, and vegetables. And once this group got going, the soil really improved. And he also increased the diversity. So he added some tall, you know, mostly nut trees and nitrogen-fixing trees like acacia and locust, and then the orchard trees and native and non-native, and he probably grew 20 different kinds of citrus. Satsuma mandarins was his main commercial crop, and this was a commercial orchard, by the way. He shipped out 200,000 pounds of citrus each year, and the harvest alone lasted for 4 months. All the work was done by hand, and so by doing that, he was thinking, his approach was, instead of thinking, how about doing this and how about doing that, he took the opposite approach, and he said, how about not doing this and not doing that? And what that means is, he looked at every agricultural practice, basic ones, plowing, flooding the rice field, pruning, making compost, I mean, everything that people were doing, and he asked, is this really necessary? And eventually he found that none of them were. And it came after 25 years, he said, this is one of his lines that he used quite often, after 25 years, all I'm doing is scattering seeds and spreading straw. But it took me 25 years to achieve this simplicity. He's eliminating. When people plow the soil, that sets in motion so many things. It sets in motion the depletion of the organic matter, leaves the soil open to erosion. It wipes out the habitat for insects. You know, it destroys the structure of the soil so the water and the air doesn't go through as easily. So, when he first started, and there was no diversity in the orchard, he grew chrysanthemums so that he could make pyrethrum, an organic spray, to control worms and other insects in his, where he was growing vegetables. Once the diversity was established in the orchard, he didn't have to do that anymore because he had natural control. Once he stopped plowing primarily and grew this continuous ground cover, he didn't have to fertilize anything. When he grew fruit trees to grow according to their natural form, he didn't have to prune, and so forth. And so when he talks about do-nothing farming, he's not talking about no-work farming, because if you have an acre and a half of rice field and a 14-acre orchard, you're going to be busy. You're going to be working, but it's unnecessary work that really got to him. So do-nothing means all of these unnecessary activities that people generally do. So I want to go to the slides, but I just want to give you an idea just of what this orchard was like. You walk out in the morning and there's chickens running around, and the trees and the many, many different kinds of plants, and in the spring it was absolutely wonderful. It was wonderful in all seasons. But what you were looking at was
nature itself, because he did not design the orchard. For the most part, he scattered seeds of all kinds. He mixed up a lot of seeds and put them in clay pellets. And he said each one, he had trees and shrubs and ground cover plants, and in each clay ball was a miniature organic farm. He called it a universe unto itself. And he tossed thousands of those all around his property. So what came up was not his design. He's trying to take human decision making out of the picture. Remember, going back to his original thought, it was people thinking that they knew better. And after all, how can people know better than what a seed knows? A seed, you put the seed out there, the seed knows exactly what to do. We're only guessing, because we have to rely on our intellect, and something is as, and science. Okay, I was going to use a bunch of adjectives, but I'm going to go easy on science this time. Fukuoka-san, although he was a scientist, trained as a scientist, he was not a fan of science. This is an intellectual. People have an people who lived, the indigenous people, who have true culture. This is that humans, as we have evolved, and then starting, say, 200,000 years ago, Homo sapiens, and 150,000 years ago or so, cognitive abilities, and then all of this interaction with nature and the land, and we did things and saw the result, and the knowledge and all of the, and the interaction with nature helped to make our lives more abundant and more secure, and it made nature actually became more diverse and more abundant for all species, and this knowledge was passed down from generation to generation. Now at that time, we were not using science and we were not analyzing with our intellect. We were learning from animals and plants and from our interaction and getting feedback. This is intuitive understanding. People were talking to animals. If you talk to Native Americans or Native people anywhere in the world, and then, or read what they're saying, or even talk to people who are still alive, Native people who remember, oh, of course they talk to animals. They talk to animals. What do you mean? That was a matter of course. So that's how people learned. And when we decided that we were better than other species and that the world was created for us and we could do whatever we wanted, we separated ourselves from nature and we lost the ability to understand the world intuitively. Instead of living within the world, we were separated and looking at the world, and we couldn't, we don't know what the hell we're doing. We have to rely on our intellect. There's no touchstone for truth. I forget where I was when I started off on that, but I'm glad that I was able to put that out there. So essentially what Fukuoka's world is the indigenous understanding. It's intuitive. Oh, he talked to plants all the time. Well, first he could just take a glance and he could get the feeling, and that's fine. But if he was confused, he would seriously ask the plant, what's going on? What do you need? Always trying to serve nature. His method relied on nature's unique ability to produce abundance all by itself. Oh, I've done that again. So all he was trying to do was get nature whole again, and ride along with that, let nature lead. And when we are doing the design, let's say, designing our own orchard or our permaculture garden, then that is really an intellectual process. Although it's patterned after nature, it's an intellectual process. And so that clearly puts permaculture and organic farming and industrial farming into the realm of the human understanding after, let's say, the fall. The fall after the separation is a better way to put it. After the separation, Fukuoka's gardening is the way people interacted with nature before that. So the heart of natural farming is to put nature back to where it's whole and can produce abundance and balance by itself, which is what it wants to do. That's and also to put ourselves back to our original mind, is what Sensei referred to it as. And that is the way that we lived within the world before. There's no separation. So healing the separation of our modern thinking to what is possible is really the heart of the whole thing. So let's do a few slides. And you'll see some examples of how that way of thinking comes out in the physical world. Oh, so, though, I forgot to mention, I have written a book about Fukuoka-san. This has been, let's see, I met him in 1972 or 3, so this has been, I don't have a calculator, it's been a long time that I've been doing this and giving talks like this and so forth. And the same issues keep coming up. People have a really hard time understanding Fukuoka-san's way of seeing the world. And I thought for a long time, I mean, it's true that he explains this from an Eastern perspective. And for a long time, I always thought that it was the East-West thing that was confusing. And it's a little partly that he's using terms like no mind and do nothing and discriminating knowledge and so forth. But it's really not that. The fundamental reason people have a trouble understanding what he's getting at is because it's people who are living in the modern culture and creating their world through the intellect, and then as opposed to seeing the world as a child does, an infant, who just is the wonderment, and there's no distinguishing between one thing or another, and no judgment. Things like, well, up or down, but strong and weak, you know, beautiful and not beautiful, and all of these things, none of that exists in nature. That only exists in our human world. So anyway, I thought it would be nice to explain Fukuoka's understanding in a way that Westerners could understand a little more easily, or anybody. And also I tell a whole bunch of stories in this book about living at his orchard and what it was like day to day, and a lot of them are pretty funny, I think. And then he came to the United States for 6 weeks twice, and I took him around. And so I thought I'd share that experience with people. And then also talking about this, comparing natural farming to indigenous ways and traditional Japanese agriculture, organic farming and permaculture, so that's also in there. And I guess that's mainly, now I'm doing a kind of going around the state of Washington, I'm mainly visiting friends, but also giving a talk, and other people would refer to this as a book tour, I guess. But it's really all about France. So that's the book. So when I first came to Japan, I was living in agricultural communities, kind of And one of them was in the mountains north of Kyoto. And so this was, I don't know, it's some of us on the commune, and this is a mayor and the chief of police, and they just came over just to say hello, and so we took a picture like that. We blended into the community fine once they saw that we knew how to work and that we brought these rice fields that had been, we took over a farm that had been neglected for many years. So we turned an eyesore into a nice farm, and we were using the traditional Japanese farming techniques, and gradually we went out there and transplanted rice with everyone else and harvested and trimmed the weeds and the irrigation channels and so forth. This is before I went to Fukuoka-san's farm. This was not our farm, it was next door. This is just a nice picture of a typical farmhouse and compound. There were some outbuildings. This is also not quite Fukuoka's farm, it's right nearby. This is such a typical view of the Japanese countryside. So the rice, it looks like October, beginning of October. The rice is ready for harvest. The front rice in the front has been harvested, hanging to dry for a little while. And then the rice in the back, the green, is about to be. And the village is in the foothills, out of the prime area for cultivation. There were so many people in Japan and so little arable land that they had to make intensive use of every square inch. So the villages, so their vegetable gardens and the orchards and so forth were in the foothills. This is Fukuoka-san at about 62 or 63 years old. I recently redid the order of these slides with the help of somebody on Vashon Island when I was just there. So, and this person was thinking, oh, show this slide to indicate that from here, you've arrived at Fukuoka-san's farm and the next slides are going to be of his farm. You know, I traveled with him a lot, and I was the one that was arranging his itinerary and trying to keep the show on the road and stuff. I have almost no photos of the two of us together because I was taking them all the time. But this is one that I do have. So I was about 24, 25 years old then, and was standing in a field of barley. This is one of the huts in the orchard where the students live. This is actually the hut where I lived for 2 years, along with one other fellow all the time, and three or four others, depending on who happened to be there in the space. It was also the kitchen for everyone, and then there were other huts scattered in the orchard. There's another one of the huts, and you can see the, you know, citrus tree, mixed ground cover, but we're going to see better pictures of the ground cover coming up, and the tall acacia trees that were, you know, for fertilizing, and also when they grew up. These acacia trees, see how big they are? So that's about 8 or 9 years old. They grew really fast, and so when they got to that size, he would cut them down and use the wood for firewood and for building, but he would plant other acacia trees, so that was happening all over the orchard. And eventually he decided that was entirely too much work, and then he just started scattering seeds of acacia trees. And he said, why should I decide where the trees are going to be? Why not just let nature decide which seeds are going to grow up into trees? That's kind of his way of thinking. It's a completely different thinking of agriculture. I mean, here where we feel like we need to be in control, because if we're not in control, how is nature going to know what to do? This is a typical thinking, believe it or not, of us. And so he's trying to get away from that. It's all about letting nature do it, give nature the tools, and see what happens, giving up control, it takes a leap of faith. But when you compare the look and feel and everything about controlled farm, as opposed to what happened when he took that approach, it's night and day. So these are four of the people who were living at the farm when I was there. I'm on the left, and Kurosawa-san had just come back from he had just come back from a one-year tour of organic farms in the United States. He met Ruth Stout, he went to Malabar Farm, he went to all over the place. And so he was one of the other two people that helped to translate the One Straw Revolution. He's an English teacher now, and a natural farmer. But just like here, very few people can make a living just farming these days. You kind of need to have another job as well, and that's the case for him as well. The persimmons drying, they've been peeled and they're hanging to dry up there. I'm just anticipating, because whenever I showed this slide and didn't mention that before, everybody said, hey, what are those things hanging? So this is a picture of his rice. His rice was shorter than the others. It was dark green and had many grains to the head. And it was clover and straw on the surface. There were insects everywhere, and it was so different from, you know, the neighbors right next to us. Pale green plants, flooded field, the soil has been turned into mush. No insects, no weeds. It's really weird when you think of it. When you see nature, you get an idea what nature is doing. And then you see the rice fields in Japan, or generally agricultural fields anywhere, commercial agriculture. It's just strange. So, so this is that tool, the kama. Is a tool that every Japanese farmer carries with them whenever they go out into the fields or the garden. It's kind of like our Falco pruner. Nobody would go out to in this nursery or out to a... No, you always have your pruners in Japan because it rains so much and it's so grassy, that tool. So this is the beginning of the rice harvest. There's no point to go into the whole thing about the rice and barley rotation. I don't think that's... We don't have forever, but the rice, this is the end of October. The rice has been harvested, but he sowed the seeds of barley about a month before. So even while the rice was growing up and ripening in the field, the barley is already coming up, little seedlings. When the rice is harvested and sunlight hits those seedlings, they pop right up so that all that greenery on the bottom, that's the barley crop. So there's no space between the rice and the barley for the weeds to come in. And also he spread the rice straw, over the barley crop, and he spread the barley straw over the rice crop. And he had white clover growing on the surface all the time. And so, it's a growing... grain without plowing is really an exercise in learning how to control the weeds. And he said once he understood how to control weeds in his grain crop, that was a turning point for him. And he said that the real turning point was realizing that if you have a crop in the field all the time, that it makes it really hard for the weeds to find a place to get in there. So in the spring, he flooded the field for about a week, and so the rice would have a chance to come up, and the clover couldn't handle the flooded field. So it sort of, if he didn't do anything, the clover would be so strong that it would not allow the rice to come through. He was using it as partly for weed control, for grassy weeds, and rice is a grass. And so what he did, he held water in the rice field for a week, And the rice can grow either in a flooded field or not. So it didn't, rice didn't care, but the clover couldn't stand anaerobic conditions. So the clover kind of passed out, and as soon as the rice got to this stage where it was above the clover and the roots were below the clover, then he took the water out of the field and the clover came back, and this is that stage, right, when the clover came back. It's a simple but sophisticated system. So this picture was taken 30 years after we stopped plowing. So what this shows is the stratification has returned to his field. The neighbors, you won't see that. It's all one monolithic profile because they flood it and they plow it. And here it's gone back to a stratified look of a natural grassland ecosystem. So there's a hint of what it's like when you take this approach. It's just a riot of things happening that you are not trying to control. And it gets to be it gets to be incredible, like nothing you've ever seen or felt before. Just seems like all overgrown, but in such a wonderful way. It feels good. It feels right. You can sense. It goes back to way deep in the subconscious where this is the way things can be, or were, are, can be. So anyway, this is just a hint of it. And here's one of the... This is during the citrus harvest, and the fellow in the lower left, that's his son, Masato. He had five children. Masato was, I think, the second born. So he knew, because he's the oldest male, that he was going to be taking over the farm. He knew that all the time. And he did. And when Fukuoka went off traveling to Africa and India and everywhere, he managed the farm for a long time, and then now his son is running the farm. So it's already, since I was there, it's been several, you know, generations. It's been kind of neat. So this is probably the neatest area in the orchard, because the trees aren't exactly planted in rows and they're fairly young, but what I want to show in this picture is the ground cover. Now, the ground cover gets up to be this tall. The next few slides are going to show that. It gets up to be 4 feet and all amazing and mixed and colorful and stuff. But once a year, in some places twice, but mainly once a year, with a long handle scythe, he cuts the ground cover and leaves all the trimmings right on the surface. And then it just grows back. And this is, again, perennials, flowers, mixed everything, ground cover, vegetables. And so this picture was taken about, I'd say, a month and a half after the ground cover was cut right at ground level. So it's coming back, and you can, well, can you sense how good this kind of thing, this treatment is for the soil? And how the soil will actually, even though he takes 200,000 pounds of fruit from the orchard, that the soil actually improves each year.
So he doesn't prune his trees, does he?
He what?
He doesn't prune his trees, or does he?
He prunes the trees if they've been damaged, like by an animal or by snow or something. But he only prunes to get it to go back to its natural form. If you get a tree seedling that hasn't, the main leader hasn't been snipped, and it just grows out normally if you grow it from seed,
then just let it grow to its natural form. It's better off without pruning. And the trees that were grown that way were stronger against insects and diseases. They lived longer. They were more robust. But he did graft some of his trees, especially the ones that were key to commercial production. And that was mainly Satsuma mandarins was his main crop. Okay, so this is the ground cover coming back after a month and a half. Now here, he's standing in, too bad it's not a little bit darker, but I think you can get the idea. He's standing in, the white flowers is radish, and the yellow ones are mustard, and in this area, the whole hillside became mustard and radish, and it might stay that way for 2 or 3 years, but then by their presence, the soil will be changed in some way that will make it so that the advantage for mustard and radish is no longer there, and they'll move somewhere else and something else. It will go through a succession. So each year, the pattern of the ground cover was different. But it was always packed with something. It's everything.
So did he seed every year, or is this something?
Did he what?
Did he seed?
Didn't have to. He just let everything go to seed.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. But he did, you know, continue to toss out seed balls where he thought it was would be a good idea. And he just did that all by intuition. Somebody asked him once if he did his gardening by the phases of the moon or by celestial body and so forth. And his answer was pretty to the point. Planting by the phase of the moon, it sounds like something that people have thought of. Therefore, I don't use it. Now, whether he actually did, you know, you got these biodynamic calendars and all of these ancient ideas about by the phase. It could be that he was actually doing that according to the schedule that someone else has figured out, but he wasn't doing it according to, he's doing it just by feel. He did it by feel and from talking to plants and asking questions. He just asked nature questions. And when he put out, when he was first starting and he put out 20 different kinds of ground cover, to see which one would be a good leguminous ground cover, he just put it out there. He wasn't trying to understand nature or to see how nature worked or anything like that. He was asking a question. He said, please, you know, please tell me which ground cover I should use. And he observed and he clearly saw that white clover was best. So we went in that direction. This is all about asking questions and letting nature take the lead instead of figuring out through the intellect that it would be a good idea if we did this and that, which is essentially a guess. And it's not going to turn out well from his point of view. It can't. Now, I don't expect that you will buy this. I'm just trying to explain his point of view. Okay, and what you do with this is completely up to you. But it's funny how this turned out when I think about what I was sitting here and all of that. It's funny that I am kind of like the keeper of the lineage. So I can't compromise. I can't say that you should mix this or that. All I can do is give you the pure message, and you can do with it anything you like. But I'm just telling you where he's coming from. And he said a lot of things that are entirely too strong and too direct to say, like, in a group like this. But something like that, people have thought it up, therefore I don't use it. I think that's okay. Huh? It gets the point across. But the one thing that people really have a hard time with is the indigenous culture I described that was passed down
from the beginning of human history. This he considered true culture. It's a partnership. It's when people were living with nature, it's a partnership with nature. So the understanding that people learned all during this time, all of that's fine, because it's a product of true culture. But the culture that comes after people are separated from nature is not a true culture to him. And therefore, well, I don't know how to say this diplomatically, he didn't care at all about anything. Or saying like, oh, there must be a few things in the modern culture that you think are worthwhile, right? I heard a lot of people ask that. And he said, no, nothing in the modern culture is worthwhile. That's way too strong for most people, because it makes people defensive, because this is where we live. This is the way we think. We think that Beethoven is really great music and ballet, you know, the fine arts. And he didn't care about that. Not just the Western, the Eastern too. He didn't care about the Japanese arts either, the fine arts, because this is a product of a culture that's been, you know, that's off course. So anyway, I don't know. You know, when I'm a train of thought speaker, so I never know where we're going to go exactly. But it's each time it's slightly different, and I haven't been there in a while. Makes it fun for me. Makes each talk different and fun for me too. Yes.
So I'm gathering. It's not like this is my planned talk, and then we're going to have questions. So I'm just going to go from now. So I'm trying to think about what is intuition. I hear that word all my life, and I don't even know what it was. I wonder if the word play, serious play, would have anything to do with that. And I can't remember the other question. That'll come later.
Intuition. Boy, that's a good question. I don't know that I've ever thought about that directly.
He's not what using his brain.
He's not using the brain. That's
devoting what I was thinking. Himself.
What I was thinking, the first thing when you mentioned that, is that we've got this chattering going on. Uh-huh. Inside, and we see something like a tree, an oak tree, and we go, oak tree, and right away all the characteristics of an oak tree, and this is good and bad and stuff, and all of this stuff pops in. We're seeing our thoughts. We're not actually seeing or feeling. It's a feeling. So here's a maybe this will help. Now, when we talk about observation, you know, we're going to observe nature. You know, like a permaculture idea is to observe nature and then build what nature is doing into your design. So they go out and observe nature, and they've got a clipboard, and they've got all of these patterns of nature that they're looking for, and this, and they are observing, looking for, and the mind is working a mile a minute. They are the observer, and nature is what is being observed. The separation is built in. Now, when Fukuoka talked about observing nature, he was saying, when you observe the rice plant, you're separate. When you become the rice plant, then you can feel what it's experiencing. Now, people used to be able to do that. That's what I would say. Let's say this is endearing. I want to. You could call that intuition. It's more than that. It's an instinct. But it's just, they just do it. They just react. They don't have the thinking process. It doesn't stand there and go, oh, what should I do? Just does it. Knows how to do it. So I think that's the best I can do.
He spent most of his time doing that. Is that correct?
He spent, I'd say, pretty much all of his time doing that.
It seems like you'd have to. You'd have to either do that, or you'd have to be part of a culture that's been doing that.
That's right. Exactly. So Fukuoka-san grew up in an agricultural community, a community that had already separated itself. Now, the traditional Japanese agriculture had a lot of great things going for it. But they did plow, and they made tons of compost and
so forth. The way of thinking was similar, but the techniques were clearly separate. So, I just slightly just missed the train of thought there.
Mm-hmm.
More slides. Sorry.
Good, thanks.
So this is probably the best overall slide of, to give you an idea of what the orchard was like. So there's the dark green is citrus trees, but there's also, see the flowering plums and maybe cherry are mixed in, and there's the acacia trees and the conifers in the background, and there's the ground cover. That's a heck of a ground cover.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there were very few, there were a few paths in the orchard, but most of the paths were where people had walked within the last 2 or 3 days. Because after that, it all just grew bad. So the vegetable growing, he mixed the seeds of all the different vegetables and just scattered them out there and cut the ground cover and let that come down as a mulch. He was trying to take his human decision-making out of the picture, like where should the tomatoes go and the cabbage and so forth. He wanted nature to just, he provided the tools, you know, where the nature just did what it does. And so the vegetables would come up wherever, and then they would reseed themselves and become naturalized and come up year after year, and they would move around. And so there were vegetables growing pretty much everywhere across this 14-acre orchard. So when we were about to make dinner, and the person who was the cook that night gave a list of what vegetables he would like to use for dinner, then somebody would go out and find them, and he'd go here and here and here. But after living and getting to know that orchard so well as we did, we know exactly where all the vegetables were. There were no rows and no patch of this and patch of that.
Did the vegetables grow similar, like were they, did they start shrinking in size because they became more naturalized? If you look in nature, it seems as though...
Well, what happened was they reverted to their earlier genetics.
Okay.
And all kinds of strange, unpredictable things happened. And one of the things that happened was they got huge, some of them, and some of them shrank. Mm-hmm. And some of them became bitter, and some of them flavor changed, and all kinds of different things happened. But one very common thing that happened was that. Mm-hmm. They were, like, gigantic. So this is just a nice photo of him sitting, sensei sitting inside of one of the mud-walled huts. There was a raised platform of tatami for most of the hut, and the cooking was done. There was a fire pit, a square fire pit right in the center of the hut. He's just doing boiling water for tea. This is One Star Revolution. The original edition came out in 1978. So he traveled to the United States on his first trip in 1979 and came again in 1986. So these are just a few slides of that. Here he is at a macrobiotic summer camp at about 3,500 to 4,000 feet in the Sierra Nevada in California. He really had an amazing time here. Well, besides the fact that he became totally depressed about the condition of the landscape. He was impressed by the idealism and the bright eyes and all the exuberance, especially of the young people. And he went to farmers markets and the kinds of things that we take for granted, but there was none of that in Japan. And at this first stop, there were about 100 people there. And they were treating him like he was a rock star. You know? And so into it, and
he had just never experienced that before. This is the what's called the Integral Urban House. This is a long time ago in Berkeley. There were four students lived in a house in the city, and they were demonstrating urban homesteading techniques. It's one of the first of its kind in the country. So they're growing their own food, they have wind power, beekeeping, you know, so a composting toilet, using passive solar to heat the place. And so I thought he might be interested in that. And he was more interested in the people and the effect of doing things like these. First, he said, growing your own food in the city, awesome. And he said that, you know, in old Japan, all the street trees were food-producing trees. And it's all about producing food and making the most of any kind of small plot of land. He was not especially interested in the appropriate technology that they were demonstrating. Not that he put it down or anything. He was more interested in that case in the people. This is at the Botanical Garden at UC Berkeley, and we took him to the Native California section because he had been traveling all over. We had been for weeks traveling around California, so we thought he might be interested in it. But what was he interested in? The weeds growing up in the pathway. Because even a botanical garden, even native plants, well, it's a display that people had created. He was more interested in what was nature trying to do with that spot. So in a way, even if that setting, people have covered up nature with what they wanted to do. And that's the case of almost any ornamental garden you ever hear, because of tilt, the regional organization that had a newsletter and spread the word about permaculture, and right away people grabbed onto it and they started creating demonstration farms. And that's what permaculture really needed. There was a theory until people showed that it could work. And that happened here quickly because of all the idealistic people, because of the tilt organization, and because of the great climate with the rain and the super soil. And so these demonstrations came into existence much more quickly in this region than they did in other regions. So anyway, Bill Mollison noticed that. So, and he came here, taught several permaculture classes, and he came to the second International Permaculture Conference. This is just, he loved talking, especially with young people. And so this is just, you know, I love that photo. Anybody recognize that big old statue?
Yeah.
Well, this is what it looked like in 1986. I was there recently and saw that statue, and it's all weathered and gray and stuff. And so, anyway, this is when it was shortly after mintage or carpage.
And so that's Bill and...
Bill Mollison is on the right, co-creative permaculture. There's Pukwuoka in the middle, and the guy on the right is Wes Jackson,
right,
who's a kind of agricultural activist. And so it was a big deal. It was more than 700 people there. So at that permaculture conference, the three of them, Bill Mollison and Wes Jackson and Fukuoka, were on the stage, and it was together, and it was just a really, really a lot of fun. And among other things that happened was Fukuoka drew this drawing. And the drawing is, it's a horse, which is society. It's modern society that's heading straight for a cliff. And the person in the front holding out the carrot is Ronald Reagan. And the carrot he identified as money. Okay? And the two people seated on the horse is Wes Jackson and Bill Mollison. And they're facing in the other direction, trying to get the horse to go the other way. Okay? And then if you look at the tail, there's somebody just hanging on to the tail. And then he signed his name right next to it, Fukuoka.
That's him.
Right.
The guy was really funny sometimes, and especially when he got in front of a group. When he got in front of a group, like, to give a talk, he started out, you know, he's there, you know, he looks just like this. He looks like he does. He really fits the role. And he's often dressed in traditional clothing, and he'd get in front of the group, and I swear he did this for effect. But he would walk up there, and he'd kind of go like this, and then he'd crack a couple of one-liners.
Yeah.
And he'd have the people just laughing. And he built one joke on the other, and they were slightly self-deprecating, and they were this and that. And within 3 minutes, he had the audience in the palm of his hand. It's not like, I mean, he was a farmer, and he lived most of his life by himself in the orchard. It was just amazing to see him in front of a group or doing an interview for a magazine or something like that. He just really knew how to do it. He was kind of a showman, which I never would have guessed until traveling around with him in the United States. How are we doing for time? Are we okay? Pretty much. We're getting to the end of this, and then if we have time for questions, that's great. I'm not married. Obviously. I don't know. What is the time? Does anybody?
4:14.
4:14. Okay. This is one of his drawings. He would do these little cartoons that, well, it's more than a cartoon. There's a pen and ink, it's a Sumier drawing. And this is what he referred to as the cave of the intellect. Remember us talking about how we are imprisoned in our thoughts. Modern culture, people, me too. I mean, I'm not. And that's, our culture is inside the cave, and we're using picks to dig at the hard ground. And the pick is the intellect, it's science, it's trying to figure things out. And the more we dig, all we're doing is making the cave larger and making it more difficult to get out. On the other hand, there's that natural farmer outside the cave, see on the left, who's just relaxing and enjoying the sunlight, and who's not doing that, not buying into that approach. This is Marx. This is when I came up to visit with the Tilth people around 1980, and we had a Clover project going and some other things where we're trying to figure out about how to apply natural farming and permaculture to the Pacific Northwest. And so this is one of the times I came up. And then, remember this group, Mike? These are people, Mike is actually there in the lower row on the right with the brown shirt. Mike-o. And I'm up on the left, upper left. I mean, right. Is that right? Yeah. This group, we worked on a book called The Future is Abundant. It came out in 1982, and this was, again, about applying these more creative ways of farming to our region. And there's the book. And this is just a very nice photo that I, to remind myself that this is the last photo. So this is in Berkeley, California. It's at the marina overlooking the San Francisco Bay with the Golden Gate Bridge in the background and the fog coming in. And this was a park. It was a park that was native plants. It was all native plants there, and I thought he might be interested in it. And also, we had some time, so, and it was a gorgeous day. That was the same day we went up to the botanical garden, and he's looking at the weeds, and then we went to the that place where they were demonstrating appropriate technology and all that. It was a super day.
So, you didn't take him out to Alcatraz?
No.
The plants out there are incredible.
The what? The plants?
The plants.
They've redone the garden there.
It's been 10 years since I was there, but, you know, I'm a plant junkie, and there are things there that are nowhere else in the country.
And plus, the prisoners had a garden. And they've, and that since about started about 15 years ago. Okay. They brought that back.
Okay.
You know, we did that. So I think this is a good time to, I mean, my presentation now is over unless there's questions. And I'll be happy to answer any questions. And also, if you're interested, in my book, I've got a few copies here. That's a hard sell, right?
Yeah. I was
asking
about Hugel cultures.
Oh, yeah, Hugel culture. Hugel culture is an idea where you take branches and tree trunks from the forest and bury them slightly and fill it in with soil, get it wet, and it becomes like a long-term raised bed. And so this is very popular with permaculture people, and was especially made popular by this Austrian fellow named Sepp Pulser. So Fukuoka-san did something like that when he first was trying to rehabilitate the orchard. And he dug trenches, and he got the branches and the trunks from the forest, and he buried them in there as part of a terracing program, and thinking that that would help to revitalize the soil. After about a year and a half, he sat down and he looked at that and he said, this is entirely too much work. This can't possibly be the right way to go because it's too much work. And that was always an indicator to him. So then that's when he got the idea, instead of doing that, he'll use plants to do the work. That's when he started planting acacia trees and so forth.
So that then he could just let the leaf litter fall from the acacias and then cut them to use them for wood for cooking and just what? What did he do with the branches? Did those tend to become...
Oh, he just scattered them out, used them for trellises on the ground or anything, just put it back. But the idea was that you didn't need to bring, you shouldn't need to bring anything from the outside to supplement. And you shouldn't have anything that's so much of one, any one thing that you have to get rid of it. And so you just, doesn't matter. And whether compost, of course, you get fertilizer really fast, but what's the hurry? Why are you trying to speed up nature's process? I mean, it was important in traditional Japanese agriculture because they were driven to produce because there were so many people. Not a great idea overall.
Can you talk about, say something about grass and, you know, like our lawns and how we can change that, or did he have any opinions over it, over how
the
we...
The lawn? Yeah, he hated lawns.
Yeah.
He hated them. He called them artificial green. He said it might as well be concrete because, again, it's human. What we want to do is just covering up nature. Nature doesn't have a chance to do anything. So get rid of the lawns. Now, techniques for getting rid of the lawns. No, the main permaculture uses this sheet mulching, which is very effective.
Okay.
You know, where you spread cardboard or newspapers and then mulch of various layers. It's extremely effective, but it's hard to see how you would do that on a large scale. I mean, really, like an acre? How would you do sheet mulching over a couple of acres?
But a lot of people live and have to live in closer proximity to each other.
Yeah.
So when we're in urban areas, we already have grass. So this sheet mulching is probably the best idea to start.
And for a small scale, I'd say it's a pretty darn good idea.
Yeah.
And then you put in your, you know, edible plants or your mixed, whatever you want to do.
Yeah.
Then you don't have to take the lawn out, and you can take advantage of the organic matter from the lawn itself.
Did he speak anything of people living in cities and how to make cities greener, or what to do about, because there's so many people, did he say anything about living in the cities and how to do that?
Oh, he did say some things about that, mainly that people should grow their own food and use every possible space for growing their own food. But the exact techniques, you know, he was mostly, are you a permaculture person?
I kind of am absorbing everything.
He's mostly a zone 3 and 4 or 5 guy.
Okay.
He doesn't really focus on zone 1, which is the area right around the house where you have intensive cultivation, and permaculture lets you do
pretty much anything darn please there. And he just wasn't interested in that very much. But he did, you know, he, in the village, there was a house where his wife lived and his kids were growing up, and she had a typical Japanese organic garden there that she used for the kitchen. It was very convenient. His system is not is not so much for intensive cultivation, but for self-sufficiency. And it works better on a little bit larger scale.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Could you say anything you want to about the idea that some soils come with the mineral package that's really good for people to eat in their food and really good for plants, and some soils just don't?
Oh, that is such a huge question. And but you don't have to worry about that. Luckily, you don't have to worry about that. All you have to worry about is the soil where you live. And you get to know that personally. And then you'll find out all the characteristics of it. And eventually, if I won't say if you're lucky, but if you approach it in the right way, you will become so close to the soil that your wife's going to be jealous. You know, I mean, really, you establish a bond, the soil tells you. And then all you want to do is do what's right for the soil. And then when the soil feels that, it responds by doing whatever it can do to help you. But the specific characteristics is more than a million, there's an infinite number of soils out there. So, you know, to say, well, this one has good drainage, and this one has this and that. Then you're getting into the thing where you're passing judgment on a certain soil. And that's only, again, the soil is just what it is, but we have values on it. Now, if the soil has been damaged, then we have a responsibility to fix it so it can become whole again. And that generally is by increasing the amount of organic matter in the soil, and that solves almost everything on almost any kind of soil.
Yep. What's been your experience on here in Ashland and stuff using these natural methods? I mean, have you had an easy time transitioning to, because I have only read a copy of your book, so have you had an easy time transitioning into this?
I've had almost nothing but positive feedback, but about the message. A lot of people feel like they remember this message deep in their subconscious, but this is the first time they hear it expressed, and so forth. Again, I'm just delivering the message as clearly as I can, and then how people take that and what they do with it in their own lives. But almost universally, the response has been, that's awesome, because it's so refreshing. Because we live in a world that's centered on killing things.
Controlling.
Yeah. And this is a message that's opposite of that. And oh, thank you. It takes a big burden. And also then people feel like a little bit, I mean, a lot of people, especially in the nurturing communities that I generally travel in, people feel guilty because people, look what people have done to the world. And I'm a person, therefore I'm guilty and I feel like I'm somehow bad. This is a cultural problem that has been going on for thousands of years. Each of us, I mean, none of us individually have created this problem, and we should not take it on as in that way. We should just become part of the solution. And do the best we can to be this I don't know, in Buddhism they say a beacon of light, and then other people see you and who you are and you feel who you are, and they, gosh, and then it dawns on them, there is another way, thank goodness, I don't have to live necessarily in this world, there's another way. This is now I'm going strictly personal. And this is not Fukuoka-san, this is not his, but I don't know, maybe he would
learning to relax into the natural world and letting it do its thing and just taking from it what we can.
It takes a huge burden off. It makes life tons, a lot easier. It's everything that our culture is doing is swimming against the flow of what nature wants to be. We are swimming upstream. And what Fukuoka-san is, saying is, just kind of relax and get into the flow. And it's not just how we interact with nature, it's how we see ourselves. And we need to do that inside as well, or is it the same as at the same time as the outside? Yeah? That is a, that's really impossible for me to say without being there and even or knowing the place. But remember when before you came, I mentioned that Fukuoka at first had the idea that I should just not do anything, and I don't think, and he didn't think that was the right approach. You need to interact with nature and establish a partnership. So it's not, oh, I can't do anything, but you've got to somehow feel what nature wants to do and give it what he said. I'll just tell you what he said. When you see, come to a piece of land, instead of asking, what can I get from this land, you say, what does the land need? How can I serve nature? And you go and see, how has the land been damaged in most cases, because that's the world we live in. And how can I fix that and put nature back together? And nature is probably going to be a little bit suspicious or not. I mean, it's going to take a little while to get to establish trust again. So, and then, I mean, I can't possibly suggest to you techniques. So this is an approach.
So like you could just pick a space and, you know, if we have slightly large piece of property, so, you know, and it is, you know, trying to find a spot where you can learn, because I know just from looking at it, you know, there's huge areas where only scotch broom and grass grow, and then the rest where it's everything, the undergrowth, the you know, all of the trees are all still there the way that it was before there was house there. But then you've got the front yard where they try to cut grass. We grow rocks. So
it
seems like they scrape all of these rocks at the heart of it.
Working on it. Yeah. You know, it's just too, without being there, it's just too hard.
So I can fill in that a little bit for you. So Masanobu Fukuoka, one of his things is the seeds will do well where they do well at. It's kind of a little bit random, but the seeds will find their own home where they are best suited, and you'll find that by being kind of random, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And I encourage you to look up Masanobu Fukuoka's seed ball video, and he'll put like 50 varieties of seeds in a cement mixer with some dirt and clay and make seed balls. And he will, he was talking about going over, talk to India about working on mangrove fields by just flying a plane over and spreading seed balls over desolate areas that needed food forests, essentially. So things will do well where they'll find their own space, essentially, is what I'm trying to go at.
And I've done similar kinds of things in, okay, well, I'm not, I bought all these kinds of broccolis and kales, and I'm not going to get around to sowing them individually. We'll just mix them all up, and it's time to go out and plant them and scatter them. And my Lord, the things that come up, the things that do well, off of 6 kale plants, I harvested over a gallon of kale seed to then throw other places, mm-hmm. you know.
Seed balls and straw.
I'm sorry to have to bring this to a close. I'm going over to Traditions Cafe.
Oh, have a good time.
At 6, and we have to just, I just have to keep this show on the road.
Alrighty.
Okay.
So thank you so much.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
If you're interested in a book, I've also got his original book, The One Star Revolution, and another one, Sowing Seeds in the Desert, if you're interested.
You can go down there before they close the Traditions, or they give us a key to the place open, so we're just going to go down and keep the conversation going for
you. Okay.
Yeah, very soon on.
Great. If you want to just move over there, that'd be awesome.
Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.